Man, that's tough one to follow right there. Coach Moreland was big time with all the RPO stuff, man. That was awesome. So got me jacked up, man. So he makes it tough, man, throwing the RPO away from the back and tough. We got to sling the fits and push the fits based on quarterback eyes and not just where the back is, man. Didn't make it easy on us. So great job. That was a great presentation. I'll go ahead and get my screen going here. You see that, Drew?
Yep, we got it. Yep.
Okay, all right. I didn't make a real fancy PowerPoint for this one, not knowing how much, you know, 15 minutes. I know you said we could run over, but just talk through our basic structure. We're odd front. We play a lot of two-high defense. We're going to be in a lot of quarters, read two, even some zone match cover two and sprinkle in some Tampa two with it. But talk about just basic structure here is for us up front, and you guys may know who he is, I came from a over-under Tampa 2 defensive structure as a young coach. So going into, odd, it was really weird. So I had to find some guys that I could talk to and get some film and watch and see, you know, who we wanted to be as a defense. And one of my buddies, Jerry Montgomery, who's a D-line coach at Green Bay, been at Michigan, been at Oklahoma. He coached with a buddy of mine when they were both at Northern Iowa. So Coach Montgomery taught me a lot about defensive line technique, two-gap defensive line technique. And so how we structure our front and the technique we play with our defensive line, with our mirror attack, two-gap technique is all due to him. And, he was my Yoda when it came to that and how we wanted to fit things and the structure we wanted to be. So for us, we're going to get my pen to draw here. Okay, we're going to be – up front, we're not always going to be four eyes, so we're not always going to be tight front like you see people play. We do, you know, and I'll talk about why. So whether we're a four or four eye, and for clinic purposes, they're both B-gap players, all right? I'll talk about a four eye playing lag here in just a minute and got video of it. But we're going to play these guys different ways, but just for this clinic, they're going to be B-gap players. So for us structurally, if I am away from the back – okay, I'm going to line up in a four technique, all right, because obviously majority of the run game is going to come across the quarterback's face, right, away from the back. So we're anticipating, you know, a double team there, you know, whether it's inside or outside zone. You know, we're putting us in position to play a double team and not get overtaken as if we were a four eye. Now all of a sudden that tackle's got a down angle on us, okay, and he can overtake us. So get my eraser here. So we want to be a four away from the back. To the back, we're going to be a four eye. Okay, and obviously a big reason we want to do that is so we don't get cut off on zone away. Okay, the other thing we get playing four and four eyes is we get arc zone read, right? And they read that guy. So a lot of times with this four eye, instead of reading the tackle, okay, we're going to read the outside tip of the guard, all right? So that way we can surf, okay, pop and squeeze, whatever you want to say, with that guy, all right? He's going to take first threat. So if it's Zier, downhill zone, okay, he'll take first threat, all right? And I'll talk about our backers. We'll end up having one of our inside linebacker be the quarterback player as we talk about how we rock back those inside linebackers, where we say stack, track, fall back. So that's the basic structure. So again, to talk about the front as far as gaps go, the nine technique, if he's got an attached tight end, he's going to be the hammer force player. Okay, he's responsible for turning the ball back inside. All right, if we're playing some form of drop eight quarters, he, you know, to a tight end, we're playing, you know, open quarters over here. So he's the D-gap player. He's the force player. our fours, again, our fours are playing B gap. All right. Fours are four eyes. Our nose is playing lag. So without getting too heavy into a D line, making it a D line presentation. Okay. This guy, all right, we're going to mirror step the center. Okay. We're going to play right through his face mask through his back half. So he's going to end up playing the backside A gap. All right. But I'm real big on not saying, hey, just tell the guy to play behind the block, because we want to mirror step and knock back the center. Okay. We've got some other techniques that are more vertical, like what we call jet, where he'll actually get vertical tee off and we want to try to drive the center, you know, back into the backfield. We play mirror two gap technique. We're going to be more, horizontal. We're going to be more east and west. We're not looking to get penetration. Okay. When we're in this, we're playing this technique. So for us, our backers is a base key. Okay. We're going to key. All right. So both these guys are going to key through the offset guard tackle to the tailback. All right. So we're going to see through these guys, but our main key is the tailback. We want to see the path of the back. You know, we're big on seeing through guys or under keying, but we don't want a primary key like the guard, or we don't want a, you know, primary key offensive lineman. All right. We want to see the path of the back, and that's going to determine our first steps. Okay. Especially, you know, a couple of years ago, when I was a head coach, when we first went to odd front, you know, we started getting a lot of dart. We started, you know, seeing a lot of tackle pull, right? We started seeing a bunch of that. So, you know, if I'm this guy, how do I coach this guy on what gap to play? Because, you know, and, you know, he should be honoring the pull and fitting over there, not, you know, spiking the A gap there. So we want to make sure we see through linemen, but we want a primary key. We want a primary key to tailback. All right. So if we're, you know, if it's same side run game, or you're getting quarterback run game, like we're getting, you know, quarterback counter, they flash the back and run quarterback counter, or it's same side counter, same side power. All right. Then what, if we're worried about that, that becomes an issue, then it becomes a triangle key. All right. So I'm going to see through guard tackle to the back. All right. As soon as that back steps in, all right, my eyes are going to go to the backside. Okay, or the flow side guard and tackle. All right. So that's just a basic way of how we key things and how we're going to under key and be able to see pulls, whether they happen to the back. All right. Or we can triangle. All right. If we get flow, if we get flow this way, our eyes are going to go over here and we're going to pick up pulls coming in the back. All right. So we should one step, same side run game. Step, C, all right, and we'll rock back. All right, but I'm going to mainly talk about inside zone. I've got some gap scheme fits. Coach, if we have time, if anybody's interested in wanting to watch it, some spill overlap run fits versus gap scheme. But for us, I've heard some people call it, you know, rock back. We call it stack, track, fall back. And the only thing that means is we're going to, on flow, we're going to work to stack on the next defensive lineman. Okay. So, all right. Our R, which is what we call our rock, is going to work to stack on the four. Okay. And then we're going to read the back from there, or we're going to track the back. All right. So I'll put it up here. We're going to stack. Okay. Then we're going to track the back, and then we're going to fall back. All right. With inside zone. All right. So obviously, you know, the depth of the back is huge, but, you know, the team we played in the state championship game, he was the head coach at Tulsa University and coasting college for a long time, won several state championships in high school. He calls their plays. He's an unbelievable offensive mind. So, but they always ran inside zone and outside zone from the same depth. So it didn't, you know, depth of the back didn't matter whether he was even or in front of the quarterback or behind. It didn't matter. So, our first movement is going to be, we're going to work to stack. We're going to work to stack. All right. As the ball, if it stays front side and they run mid zone, then we're going to stay front side with it. Okay. All right. If it's veer, all right, downhill zone, then now what these guys are going to do, they're both going to fall back with the ball. All right. So they're going to stack and then they're going to fall back. Okay. The front side guy would end up falling in. Okay. Falling back to the A gap. All right. If we're playing Let me erase this here. Looks like our board in our office. Okay, so I'm just drawing up zone first, okay? All right, we're going to target those guys. All right, so he's the B-gap player. He's the A-gap player, B-gap player. All right, he's the D-gap player, force player. So we're going to stack, all right, fall back on the inside zone, all right, if we're getting any kind of inside zone path. Same thing, work to stack, all right, fall back. The one thing we've got to do a better job of is we work to stack instead of working downhill to stack, okay? We need to be more lateral, okay? We need to be horizontal, okay? Because like talking to Coach Barti at Cal, he goes, you know, who's trying to block you? You know, these guys are trying to block you. So why would you go toward somebody that's trying to block you when, you know, why would you go this way when your gap is going to end up being, you know, backside, you know, or, you know, away from your initial movements? And so that's one thing we've got to get better at is being more lateral, being flatter with our shuffle, even on inside zone, and not matching this path quite as much. So, okay. All right. So, work to stack, inside zone. We're going to fall back. And so what this guy wants to do is he wants to fall back and he wants to chase this four eyes ass and be as tight as he can with his shoulder square and be ready. If that ball winds all the way back, this four eye does a good job staying in his gap as that ball winds back. Okay. Being able to make a chest to chest phone booth tackle there. Okay. Tight right off that, right off the four eyes backside. Okay. And then the front side backer is going to be in the A gap. All right. And like Coach Moreland was talking about, you know, reading guys away from the back, you know, makes it difficult. So I know I have on here with our overhang players, and I'll just talk about it real quick. Camp rules, or we're gonna you know, be in the fit if the back's away, all right? Okay, and we get mesh, then we're gonna trigger. If the back's to us and we get a run mesh, then we're gonna be a hold and fold player, all right? We're gonna hold off. Okay, the RPO to two, all right, whether it's, you know, whether it's hitches, okay, whether it's, you know, whether it's bubble, but we're going to sit. Also, alignment-wise, we're going to be plus one, we're going to be apex plus one towards the number two receiver, all right? So we're gonna loosen our fit knowing that we're not primary, all right? If it was same side run game, all right, he's going to fall in late, but say it was same side power. Okay, he's going to chase and spill, and this guy's going to overlap. So, again, numerically, we don't need that overhang player. Even on same side gap scheme, the overlap player is going to be the free hitter. And you know, it's going to take a long – it takes a longer time for that power, you know, to the same side power versus a 3-4 versus odd spacing to get front side, because there's no, you know, there's not going to be an A gap entry play versus that front, you know, based on the structure and how offensively they want to block you. If it was mid zone or outside zone with our backers, we would not fall back. We would stack track and we would be front side. So if we got outside zone or mid zone, these guys are going to still work to stack and then they're fitting off the ball. All right, here in a minute, I'll show you the video. We're playing the state finals and their back makes a drastic cut. All right. Ends up winding all the way back and you'll see our backside linebacker. I mean, he's in the front side A gap almost, and he rocks all the way back, with the back. So, you know, for me as an over under Tampa 2 system guy coming up as a young coach, this was like Chinese, man. This was like completely out of my league as far as understanding. So, Coach Hall, who's now the DC at Troy, taught me a lot about when he was at Oklahoma under Coach Venables, and they went to the odd front. Let's see if we get the video here. They went to the odd front in the late 2000s, right before Coach Venables left, and really taught me a lot about how to fit run game as well, and what their what their thoughts were, and because it was so drastically different than really what I knew. All right, we'll get to a couple clips here. All right, so we're in our odd front. Okay, we're playing read two here to the field. Okay, we had a coverage we called it deuce. So if they came out in a sniffer set, okay, we're gonna play read two strong. And this guy, this safety here, he's off the back. All right, he's off the sniffer. So if the sniffer was strong, okay, this guy, it became a 2-3 push, right? So he was gonna end up pushing. All right, and this guy became like the mic, or what our buck is, our strong side song. So it became a 2-3 push for him. So he became the push player. So we didn't have to push this guy. All right, and then essentially we're playing press quarters, or you could play even Meg into the boundary to the weak side there. So you'll see this guy, our field apex player, actually fits it wrong. Okay, you'll see him. It's pistol, so for us, it's we'd have to, like, if we were playing Coach Moreland, which I'm glad we don't, you know, we pistol, you've got to know whether you're in or out of the fit based on the turn of the quarterback. And like Coach was talking about, his vision. And if we're getting RPOs away from the back, all right, let's say the back was here, all right, and they're throwing RPOs to this side off the safety, okay, in split coverage, then we've got to read vision. All right, to know if we're in or out of the fit, which is tough. It takes a lot of work. So, you know, generically speaking, you know, we're going to worry about back alignment. But if it's pistol, we've got to read it almost like they can throw RPOs away from the back, and we've got to see post-snap who's in or out of the fit. All right, here's the back, the backer, the fallback backer, okay? All right, 28. He's going to work to stack. He falls back tight. Right off our four, who gets washed. Plays too high and turns his shoulders is really what kills him. We'll get to the end zone shot here. It's a better shot of it. They fastballed us. All right. The camera cuts in late. You can see him fall back. You can see him. He kind of gets lost behind 74 and there and 53, their big offensive line. Okay. You can see him rock back. You can also see our rock backer, 33. He almost works all the way front side. He's A gap, right? He should be stacking, falling back into the A gap. Okay. He sees 28 shoulders turn. He falls all the way out of his A gap. And ends up almost overlapping the buck. All right, so now I was talking about it earlier. So now this guy's going to play a lag technique. So he's not a B-gap player, all right? He's going to play through this guy's midline, and he's going to end up playing through his back half behind the block. So he's going to end up, if they did run zone read, all right, or zone, he would end up being the quarterback player. He'd end up being the C-gap player, all right? This guy's got to know what technique we're playing, all right? We do it with calls. How we call the front tells these guys what technique they're playing. So this guy's going to work to stack. As he falls back, he's going to fall back into the B gap instead of nesting behind the four eye like I was talking about on the diagram. He's going to fall back into the B gap. So you can see him fall back on the drastic cut, and you can see the back shoulders turn square, and then he cuts it back. So the back level, you know, for us, because they would run inside zone off that same back level, because Coach Blankenship's really, really good offensive coach. So again, they weren't going to give us, you know, an easy tendency with the level of the back. You can kind of see how you can see 67 there. End up playing through the backside and falling back just to give the offense a different, it allows us to play different gaps with these guys without having to slant the front, okay, without having to move guys, maybe get washed or you guess wrong. So we can play these guys as B-gap players. We can play them as C-gap players, as lag players, or we can two-gap them, all right, where they're going to have a primary key and a secondary key. And they're going to play two gap based on what this guard does. All right. Whether there were B gap or C gap players, whether he was down or whether he was doubling them. Good patience by 33. work to stack. It's a good job by our nose guard playing the double. You can see him sit into it, playing the lag, not letting the center climb front side. All right, so now here's an example. All right, and the end zone kind of sucks on this shot. Our nose guard here is playing, we're playing front side, so we're playing two gap, and you'll see it. So this guy plays at Nebraska, so he's a really good player. So it allowed us to do, you know, a lot of different things. A little bit tougher to play two gap at nose unless you're just really dominant. And this is Tulsa Union, who's an outstanding football program here in Oklahoma, you know, similar to Jinx. Several state championships, you know, Division I players every year. Both their starting wide receivers, their X and Z, were Power 5 guys. So, you know, outstanding talent. So this guy was really good for us to be able to two-gap him against this offense. So it's going to be stack, track, fall back. But now this front side guy's got to know, again, what technique this nose is playing, because the nose, you'll see him in the A gap. So 45 will actually fall back, and he'll fall back all the way off the nose's ass to the backside. Okay. 44, all right, will fall back right off the four, because the four techniques in this clip are playing. Both of them are B gap players. I'll run it back because the tight wide's the best shot here, you can see. All right, I'll pull up the end zone. So there's 45. All right, there's 44. There's our rock, okay. Our wheel linebacker, our jack, our boundary outside linebacker is lined up too wide. But there you can see how 45 falls back behind the nose. It's a good shot of it. It's a good job of 44 teasing the guard, right, teasing it, and then falling back. And you really got to work your various block protections too, where that guy, you know, he's going to punch the guard as he comes off and you know, fall back off the guard. Got an end zone shot on this one. All right, so – this almost happens too late, all right? And 33, okay, this is an example of Zier, all right, downhill zone, okay, where they're really hitting the zone downhill. And you can see our backer there. It's really good, okay? Right now, we knew if he was even versus this team, okay, we were getting stretched. We were getting outside zone, all right? Once he moves, okay, quarterback tells him to move. You can see our backers communicating, hey, you know, level the back. He's in the level behind the quarterback to have a name for. So he starts communicating to the our weak side inside linebacker, our rock. You see how downhill he hits it. Our 4-eye makes a good play. Okay, but you can see how tight 44 is as he falls back. All right. As he falls back, we want him, hey, we're telling him, you know, it looks like it's daylight. The guy's wanting to punch it. Trust this 4 or 4-eye that he's not going to get cut off, okay? He ends up fitting tight off the 4. All right, Coach, that's all I had, man. I appreciate you having me on. I didn't know we were going to roll over. I would have had a lot more prepared, so I apologize, man, but I'd love to come back on here. Really, you did a lot of good presentations, and have kept up with you over the last few weeks, and appreciate to be glad to be a part of it, and appreciate you having me on.
Absolutely, Coach. So you did have a few questions here in the thing. So first one says, does your nose always lag to the running back when they're an offset gun?
No, he doesn't. You know, obviously the easiest way is to deal him one way or the other, okay, slant him, you know, or step him one way or the other. But we'll play three different techniques with him. Two of the techniques, he's the backside A-gap player. One of them is, the one clip of us playing Union with 99, the nose guard that went to Nebraska, we could two-gap and do some different things with him. But, no, if we two-gap the nose, We call it a push technique. And so the double team pushes us to a front side gap. And that's really a technique we use in our heads front. We play double two techniques. But again, the thing we, I like about playing, you know, fours and four eyes and two eyes is that the concepts carry over. It's, it doesn't matter whether you're lined up on a guard or a tackle. Those guys learn that this is a push technique from a head up, you know what I mean? Or a lag technique from a four, from an inside technique. And so there's a lot of carryover. So that's our other main front. We don't play a lot of over defense or under defense. We play more head ups in our four man front because it ties over or ties in and there's carryover and teaching between that and our D line technique and our odd front and even our linebacker fits for that matter.
And let's see. And then in the first clip, 20 with backside safety lining over the sniffer, is Meg your choice? And then what makes you decide that?
No, it, I mean, we have like a plethora of stuff we can run. No, that was just, you know, that was one of our tags. So like our palms is what we call Miami. So that's our read to. So we called Miami Deuce, but we could call, if we just called Miami, then we're going to play, you know, we're going to play like a poach. All right. Well, like, you know, people call poach where that the backside safety's got three vertical. So he's in or out of the fit based on back to him or back away. You know, so we can do that. We could play if it was, if we, you know, which that guy in that clip was a vertical threat, like coach was throwing RPO to their sniffer, you know, reading the nub side safety. If we were getting a bunch of that, then we're going to play, you know, we call it lock where you're playing palms on two and three and Megan one, and then you're playing, you know, some form of two over or three over two or two over one, however you want to count it on the backside. So like versus a nub, it'd be like a cloud, like what we call a comet look. But if it's an open trip set, we'll play cone or Connie. And based on the back, if the back the back was to us, we play Connie. And it's not, we don't man match it like Bama and Georgia and those guys do. We're a zone match quarters team. And zone match cover two with the sprinkle of like one rat and some ripless match cover three, but we're going to major in middle of field open stuff, but no, it depends. So we're, you know, if you give a sniffer, we're going to give you, you know, it's like coach was talking about earlier, dictating to the defense. We kind of view it the other way. We want to make sure we can dictate what we want to run. So we want to have, you know, multiple coverages to run versus, you know, 3x1 and 2x2 and you know, without being complicated to our guys, but we can give, you know, I know you guys probably know Dub Maddox, you know, he's the offensive coordinator at Union. You know, we'll play them early in the year and he's as good offensive coach as, you know, as I've ever been around at any level and have ever heard and competed against. So, you know, we've got to be, you can't line up in one coverage against Coach Maddox. Or even Coach Blankenship and these guys we play here in the Tulsa area, and expect for success. So you got to have a vast array in your toolbox ready to roll.
And then let's see. Okay, so personnel wise, do you plan on having your boundary cornerback as your best man-to-man cover guy, or do you have a corner that travels per game plan?
No, or for, you know, unless we're getting fastballed. You know, if we're getting fastballed, we're going to play right and left. You know, and you know, just roll with it that way. But our best guy, yeah, ideally is going to be into the boundary so we can play a lot of press, you know, a lot of whether it's press quarters or, you know, man-to-man concepts. And you eliminate the short throw, you know, obviously by being able to press and play some man-to-man there into the boundary on the backside of quarters or, you know, sometimes even cover two, you know, depends on how good that guy is. But, yeah, we're going to play our best cover guy into the boundary and eliminate the short throw. You know, the old, when I first got into coaching, the old thing was to play, OU used to call it 43 cloud, you know, play quarter, half and put your best cover guy to the field and put your worst, you know, or your lesser cover guy to the boundary. And because you were going to play cover two so much and play two trap and fit that guy in the run game so much that guy didn't need to be as good a cover guy. Well, it's completely opposite now, you know, as far as our thinking goes.
Let's see. Okay, so pro twins, you didn't have your outside linebacker walked up on the tight end. Is that a rule?
Like spread, like 2x2, 11? Is that?
I don't know. It just says pro twins. I'm not sure.
Yeah, because it was 3x1. I thought if that's the clip I'm thinking of. Yeah, we were in a middle of the field open coverage. I think it was the first clip, maybe. I'm not sure what he. Oh, no. I know he's talking about when we were playing Union. No, our boundary outside linebacker was loose. Well, he should have been tighter, but he was for that week, he was our starting strong safety. And so when they were in 10 or 11 personnel, we went to dime. And so we put, instead of being a regular personnel, we had basically like two nickels at outside linebacker playing. So no, he should be a backer nine technique. You know, he just didn't feel good about going up against that tight end and didn't necessarily like his matchup. So he wanted to make sure he didn't get reached.
Okay. And then kind of, it looks like the same formation there. Is your boundary safety the C-gap player in the Pro Twins example when the field outside linebacker is out of the fit?
Yes. So yes. And I'll, we call it open. So like if we have the backer nine technique, okay, then the safety is the C-gap player. If we're playing, we can play that a couple different ways. We can play it like a heavy nine technique, or, you know, some people call it a nine jam seven, you know, where that outside linebacker plays a nine, he gets a baser reach. He's going to end up playing through his midline, playing the inside gap. Like I know a lot of people do with a five technique where they play a heavy five. We can do that with a nine technique. We usually don't if he's the flat player, just because obviously it kind of, you know, if that guy slam releases, you know, on boot and stuff, well, that's, you know, that's his pass responsibility. So most of the time we do it if he's the fourth rusher, fourth activated rusher. But yeah, as a base rule in that, in to a pro flank, the safety and odd spacing is going to be the C-gap player.
Okay. Do you always have your inside linebackers inside in 20s, or do you widen them in certain situations? And then what are your rules on alignment for those guys?
We could widen them. The thing we ran into early on, because at Jinx, they were like almost 40s, actually. They were really wide and odd. But the thing we kept finding out is that as that guy fell back, he would the guy that was the nest player that would fall back to the running back side would actually fall back too wide. And the thing, you know, there'd be air between the tackle and him, you know. And so just to kind of reinforce – falling back tight, because, you know, if you're playing B gap with those fours or four eyes, you know, B gap's going to close and his fallback's going to be more downhill than it is, you know, than it is wider. But you could play him in 30s. We played him in 30s as well. So just whatever you feel comfortable with and how good that guy is, you know, how good his feel is for falling back.
All right. And then the last one, could you talk through your run fits against pro twins when the offense is running quarterback GT counter?
Yeah, if it was like if it was minus there, and they, like I said, if they flat, like let's say they, like what we call minus is the back, soft set away from the tight end. So if they flash the back and they ran GT to the open side, okay, as soon as that back steps into mesh with the quarterback, our eyes at backer are going to go to the opposite guard tackle side. And so we drill it, our linebacker coach, and it was a guy named Steve Spavital, who's sons are both coach at Texas State, Jake and Zach. I learned it from him. But, you know, you get – whether it's two guards or whether you get four offensive linemen and you get a back and you just have the back work one way or the other, where those backers have to flash their eyes and they've got to step and see the opposite side. But as that back steps in for the mesh, his eyes are going to go to that – you know, their eyes are going to go to that side. Okay, and if we get pulled, then we're one step in the counter and coming back with the pull. So – any gap scheme, you know, the difference between power and counter is just that step. So the front side guy, so if I get gap scheme at me, okay, in odd spacing, our rule is we're going to chase the four technique's ass and be a spill player. We're going to be right off that four's ass. So there's not going to be any daylight, any air between me and him. And then the backside guy is what we call an overlap player. Okay. So it's spill off the four and the backside guy is going to end up overlapping. And then from that, you know, when we say out of the fit, then the overhang player, if they pull two guys front side, then the overhang player would add into the fit there. But again, he's going to have time. At that point, the RPO is gone. You know, it's going to be, you know, quarterback actually, you know, running the football. So he's going to be a fold-in player. The overhang will at that point. But that's a tough play. Especially, you know, where it makes it tough is if it's same side GT, you know, RPO, and they're throwing hitch to two. You know, that makes it tough. So we've got to have, you know, we'll run some bracket stuff out of four-man front, some seven bracket or four robber, TCU robber quarters that kind of help us, you know, be heavier on on number two and not always give away who our apex defender is, you know, or excuse me, who our fit player is to that open side and kind of take our apex defender out.
Cool. Awesome, Adam. We appreciate you coming on, man.
You bet. Thanks for having me.